Hey, this is Dr. K from iMedicalSchool, and today we're going to talk about multiple myeloma. Let's first start off by talking about the different forms of immunity. Your body can fight off infections via two main types of immunity. The types of immunity are cellular immunity and humoral immunity. Cellular immunity, as it sounds, utilizes cells to fight off infections, such as cytotoxic or killer T cells. The second form of immunity is humoral immunity. Humoral immunity works through the utilization of antibodies. Now, cells are needed to produce the antibodies. These cells that produce antibodies are called plasma cells. Plasma cells are important to the pathophysiology of multiple myeloma. Multiple myeloma is the expansion of a single clone or type of plasma cell. Due to the proliferation of a single clone of plasma cells, there's a sharp rise in the production of a single type of antibody, resulting in what is called a monoclonal gammopathy. The rapid expansion of a clone of plasma cells and antibody production can lead to bone pain, lytic lesions, anemia, hypercalcemia, and acute kidney injury. Generally, multiple myeloma is quite rare and only makes up about 1% of all cancers. There has been a noted increased incidence of multiple myeloma among African Americans, while there's a decreased incidence of myeloma among Asians and Mexicans. The median age of onset for multiple myeloma is 66, and the cases of familial inheritance are extremely rare. Now, the symptoms and signs of myeloma are quite generalized and numerous. Symptoms and signs include anemia, fatigue, weight loss, acute kidney injury, hypercalcemia, and bone pain. In terms of anemia, it is usually a normochromic, normocytic anemia. The anemia results due to expansion of plasma cells in the bone marrow, impairing red blood cell production, as well as progressive kidney injury leading to poor erythropoietin production. Erythropoietin, or EPO, is a hormone that is released by the kidneys, more recently made famous by Lance Armstrong, and it stimulates the bone marrow to increase RBC production. So with kidney injury from myeloma, the kidneys cannot produce erythropoietin or EPO effectively. One of the hallmarks of multiple myeloma is extreme bone pain. A common finding is a reduction in height that is due to vertebral fractures. Generally, bone pain worsens with movement and tends to be seen in up to about 60% of multiple myeloma patients. Proteinuria is another common finding in multiple myeloma. It's important to point out that urinalyses only detect albumin in the urine. In multiple myeloma, patients are spilling immunoglobulins into the urine, and thus the urine dipstick will show no protein, though in reality they're spilling significant amount into their urine. If sulfosalicylic acid is added to the urine sample, the immunoglobulins present can be visualized. In addition to using sulfosalicylic acid, you can obtain a 24-hour urine and send it for protein electrophoresis and immunofixation to determine the amount and type of protein present in the urine. The electrophoresis should show a single large peak indicating one type of immunoglobulin replicating out of proportion to the other immunoglobulins. The significant proteinuria that develops in myeloma leads to acute kidney injury. There are two types of acute kidney injury encountered in myeloma. Myeloma can cause light chain cast nephropathy, otherwise known as myeloma kidney, and light chain amyloidosis. In myeloma kidney, the immunoglobulins result in large, waxy casts in the urine with a negative dipstick urine. In light chain amyloidosis, the immunoglobulins deposit into the kidney, causing significant glomerular damage and loss of albumin into the urine, resulting in a positive dipstick. In rare circumstances, patients can develop cord compression. Spinal cord compression is an oncological emergency. In myeloma, it can be due to an extramedullary plasmacytoma. A plasmacytoma is a mass of proliferating plasma cells that can occur within or outside the bone marrow. If it occurs in the spine, it can compress the spinal cord, causing severe damage. The first step is to obtain stat imaging of the spinal cord, determine if cord compression is present. Patients with cord compression diagnosed clinically or via imaging should be started on dexamethasone. A neurosurgery consult should be placed for further evaluation and possible decompression. Other features you may see in multiple myeloma include the rouleau formation. In a peripheral blood smear, you may see red blood cells stacked up on top of one another like a stack of coins. This occurs due to the hyperviscosity linking of RBCs by immunoglobulins. You can see the stack of coins that are created as pictured here. In a bone marrow biopsy, you will notice a large proliferation of plasma cells. Finally, patients will usually undergo a skeletal survey if they are diagnosed with myeloma. These films may show osteolytic lesions of the skull and vertebra. In addition, they may show osteopenia and even vertebral fractures. Now that we've discussed signs and symptoms, let's talk about the initial workup. If you suspect someone has multiple myeloma, it's important to order the proper initial workup. First, start off with a CBC with a differential to identify if the patient has an anemia. In addition, look at a peripheral blood smear to identify if low formations are present. Next, obtain an SPEP and UPEP to identify production of a monoclonal production of antibodies. Other labs include LDH and CRP to identify inflammation and cell turnover. In addition, you should get a chemistry to identify any electrolyte abnormalities or kidney dysfunction. Lastly, obtain a beta 2 microglobulin, as an elevation in beta 2 microglobulin is a poor prognostic sign. If the workup is consistent with myeloma, obtain a bone marrow sample and a bone survey. The diagnostic criteria for myeloma stresses whether organ damage is taking place. A patient needs three criteria met before diagnosing multiple myeloma. These include M protein in serum and or urine. In addition, the bone marrow must consist of at least 10% of plasma cells. And finally, there must be some evidence of organ impairment. The organ damage that is described can be represented by the acronym CRAB and includes calcium levels, renal insufficiency, anemia, and bone lytic lesions. Differential diagnoses include MGUS, or monoclonal gammopathy of undetermined significance, and smoldering multiple myeloma. MGUS, a serum monoclonal gammopathy, has less than 10% of plasma cells in the bone marrow with no end organ impairment, as represented by CRAB or lytic lesions. In smoldering multiple myeloma, serum monoclonal gammopathy is elevated with greater than 10% of plasma cells in the bone marrow, but there again is no organ impairment. Treatment of multiple myeloma includes stem cell transplant and chemotherapy. Chemotherapeutic agents include bortezomib and thalidomide. Well, that's a brief review of multiple myeloma. If you like this video, share this video with your friends on Twitter or Facebook. You can follow us on Facebook at iMedicalSchool and on Twitter at iMedSchool. Make sure to like, comment, and subscribe. This is Dr. K, and I'll see you next time.